Welcome to our concert, Songs of Migration of South Africa, dedicated to the people of South Africa who have really been able to, after 300 years, collect together such a great anthology of songs. We're playing it tonight with the London Symphony Orchestra, a few South African singers, and the community choir of the LSO. Welcome to South Africa. I grew up in Africa's largest coal mining town, Witbank. Music absorbed me from when I was a little child. When I was 2 years old, I lived for the gramophone. 2, 3 years old, I used to wait who's gonna get up first so they can hold it for me, because I wasn't strong enough to hold it and wind it up. And by the time I was 13, I went to boarding school and I saw a movie about a trumpet player called The Young Man with a Horn. I had already met Father Huddleston because he was chaplain of my school. He asked me one day, "Hugh, what do you really want to do in life?" Because I sort of was in trouble a lot with the authorities. And I said, "If I can get a trumpet, Father, just a trumpet, I won't bother anybody anymore." And he got me a trumpet and a trumpet teacher. I'd been trying for 3 years to get Huddleston to get me a scholarship so I could come and study music here. And he finally got Johnny Dankworth, who had been deported from South Africa for hanging out too much with the native people. And they convinced the Guildhall to write me a letter of acceptance, which was the only thing that I was lacking. I got it shortly after the Sharpeville massacre. And I left immediately because by then I was also like very politically involved in resistance movement and underground work. And I left in a hurry. I'd worked very hard so that by the time I got to New York, I could already really play, you know. I wanted really to, if nothing else, play in Blakey's Jazz Messengers. But they refused to give me a gig. Everybody just said, why don't you do your own thing, man? I mean, you come from Africa, blah, 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 blah. So finally, I put together a trio, and from there, I was gone. We're really like into protest music, and the anti-Vietnam War crusade was really on, and like the civil rights thing was really on. So it was a great time for anarchy. I was already very heavily involved in rubbishing the apartheid government, and my friends were people like Belafonte and Miriam Makeba and Dizzy, and it was all the anti-apartheid people. And I was unknown. So Belafonte especially sat me down and he said, man, with your mouth, you're going back there. They don't even know who you are. Nobody knows who you are. They're going to be waiting for you at the airport, and you're going straight to jail, and they can do anything with you. Nobody will know what happened to you. You know, it says, but if you stay here and you try and make a name for yourself, and you talk about your country, if you have a name, people will listen. And you'll be able to get the message across. You'll be of more use to your people than going back to them. And it made sense, so I stayed. I stayed 26 years longer than I had planned.
There's a train. Comes from Malawi, Namibia. There's a train that comes from Zambia and Zimbabwe. There's a train that comes from Angola and Mozambique, from Lesotho, from Botswana, from Swaziland, from all the hinterlands of Southern and Central Africa. This train carries young and old African men who are conscripted to come and work on contract in the gold and mineral mines of Johannesburg and its surrounding provinces and metropoli. 16 hours or more a day for almost no pay. Deep! Deep, 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 deep down in the belly of the earth. When they are digging and drilling for that shiny, mighty, evasive stone. Or when they dish that mishmash mush food into their iron plates with an iron shovel. Or when they sit in their stinky, filthy, funky, flea-ridden barracks and hostels, and they think about the loved ones they may never see again, because they might already have been forcibly removed from where they last left them, or wantonly murdered in the dead of night by roving and marauding gangs of no particular origin. So we are told. They think about their lands and their herds that were taken away from them with the gun and the cannon, with the collaborator, the dog, the tear gas and the poison, with the bomb and the Gatling. And when they hear that choo-choo train smoking and chugging and pumping and climbing and struggling and pumping and smoking, puffing and tooting and steaming and crying and moaning and wailing and screeching and screaming. They always cuss, and they curse the coal train. The coal train that brought them to Johannesburg, Stimela. Sangela tava
I got a hit during the times of Free Love, and I was a flower child, and My friends were people like David Crosby, the Jefferson Airplane people, the Grateful Dead, the Big Brother and the Whole Income. I played Monterey Pop, you know, and it was everybody. Jimi Hendrix was, you know, a great hangout pal. And we were not wild, but we didn't sleep much. The biggest record I ever had was Grazing in the Grass, which is a typical South African dance tune. And Russ Regan was the head of A&R at uni. He came to listen to, I think it was my fifth album, he came and listened and said, I like the album, but you need another song. And the saxophone player had been listening to these tapes that I just brought back from Zambia. He said, why don't we try that song, because it's simple. It's got a simple melody, it's got a bass line with four notes, bum bum, bum bum, bum bum, bum. And the drum just goes bam, choo choo, bam, choo choo. And the piano goes ta da 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 ta 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 da da da. And the guitar goes ta da 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 da. And ba da ba. So we did it in half an hour. And by the time Russ Regan came, it was mixed. You know, because it just took us a short time. Maybe we spent 2 hours on it. And he came in and we played it for him and he said, this is a smash. Thank you.
It's an old beautiful song from Brazil. It's called The Joke of Life, Brinca da Vivre. It was written by John Lucien at a time when he thought that injustice was the biggest joke of life. Brinca da Vivre.
Thank you.
I spent 1980 to 1985 living in Botswana. We had started the Botswana International School of Music, and I'd signed with Jive Records, and they had a mobile studio in Gaborone. So I came back and I lived in England for 5 years, on and off, and in the States. Then I toured with Paul Simon, then I had Sarafina. And it was during the, Sarafina was on Broadway, I think, 2 years, when I got the call that Mandela was going to, and Sisulu and Kathrad and all those people were going to let out of jail and that soon we'd be able to go home. I didn't believe it. But when I finally spoke to Miriam Makeba and my sister Barbara, at the time was Mandela's chief of staff, they put him on the phone and he said, "Yo, your ma's come home. It's been long enough now." And the next week I was on a plane. I think the greatest thing for me of getting back to South Africa was to be able to get back with the people, especially the rural, ethnic, indigenous people, and learn those things about my heritage that I didn't know. Now I'm so obsessed with all that kind of revival, not only for myself, because colonialism and apartheid dealt so much damage, not only in South Africa, but all the neighboring countries, and I guess to a great extent on the whole continent itself. And it's very important, I think, that the people of Africa get back into their heritage, because I think there lies the remedy for xenophobia. I wasn't naive because I'd lived in Botswana. I knew what the economic of Africa was indeed. I lived in the Congo, I lived in Nigeria, I lived in Ghana, I lived in Guinea, I lived in Liberia, I lived in Senegal. So I knew the terrain. So when I went back, it was, of course, personally, to be able to re-immerse myself in the culture and the society, but mostly to see what I could bring, because I had sourced so much from Africa, and I need to pay it back. And the only way to pay it back, I think, is by making the people see how wonderful they are and how excellent they are, and get them to enjoy their heritage again.
Thank you.
most unfair judgment of South Africa is the fact that people expect us to be that which they thought we're going to be, the miracle nation. But we come from a very, very untidy and raggedy and very violent past. and also a very corrupt one. And we've only been free 15 years. I say to people, listen, England has been enjoying freedom maybe for over like 10 centuries. France, you know, maybe just as long, if not longer, and like Germany and all those places. And America has been free maybe over 300, almost 300 years. But they all have problems. They still have problems. So maybe if you come back to me 800 years from now, I'll be able to say, well, we're making some headway.
Sichava sa yetu umfedi sedintwa le matenye.